When you watch a movie like The Shape of Water, it's easy to sit in awe of the world's visuals. The imagery, its colors, the costumes, the characters, or especially the characters' eyes.
In the case of the kids, I cast their eyes.
When I cast actors, I cast eyes.
Eyes?
The eyes of Sally.
The eyes of Octavia Spencer.
They are like musical notes, the eyes.
But one of the most lively, essential, and dynamic parts of a film like this is the sound. Thanks to isolated audio tracks released by the Soundworks collection, we can hear all of the sounds that bring a film like this to life. There's the dialogue.
Well, you missed me, huh? I took a candy break.
The creature's vocals and movements. The sound effects and background noises. The foley. It's important to consider all of the different elements that will go into your sound design. How do you capture audio that your audience won't explicitly notice, but feel instead?
I'm a huge fan. I've read everything you've ever written. Not too much.
First, there's the dialogue.
I have the ship's engines all over the dialogue. Seagulls. Camera noise, wind. Christ knows what else.
I don't care, Mike. You're the sound recordist. Make it work.
Capturing dialogue is most frequently done with a boom mic. A boom mic is usually a directional microphone, like a shotgun mic, attached to a shock mount and a pole. Different microphones have different pickup patterns. Omnidirectional, which means sound from all directions is captured equally. Cardioid, which captures sound in an upside-down heart shape in front of the mic. There are also more narrow versions of a cardioid pickup pattern, like supercardioid. And supercardioid is generally what you'll use on a boom pole. Regardless, it's important to point the microphone at the subject.
I'm gonna need a hand tying these fellas up on the roof.
Different actors project their voices in different ways, so where precisely to point the microphone can vary. A boom operator should aim their microphone directly at the cleanest source of sound, which almost always results in holding the mic at an angle and rotating back and forth if they're trying to capture two people at once.
Well, give OB $50 when we get to Red Rock. He'll help you.
Yeah, I think OB's right. This phone got me concerned. We can go on a whole lot quicker. You help out too.
The hell, I'm already regretting this.
One common misconception about shotgun mics is that because they have a narrow pickup pattern, that means they can be used effectively at a great distance, that they reach out like a laser beam and grab sound from far away. This is not true. They just cut out much of the noise surrounding what you're pointing at, so you still want to get the mic as close as you can to the subject.
With us today is the famed adventurer and explorer, Claude Lemon.
That's why, even in the most professional of productions, a boom mic can easily sneak into the shot.
Sometimes we will take as many.
A boom operator is often teetering right on the edge of the frame, trying to get as close as possible to the actors without ruining the composition.
Now, I understand there was great danger involved.
Yes, there were a great many dangers involved, but perhaps the most dangerous was the poisonous fish.
Poisonous fish.
Poisonous fish.
Poisonous fish.
Continue, it is your show.
But what if the shot is extremely wide? Where does the mic go then?
Cold enough for you, Chief.
One method is to hide lavalier microphones, often connected to a wireless transmitter, within your subject's clothing, or even the hair.
It's pretty amazing how these guys are able to hide microphones in ties and in jackets.
You can always use both types of microphones, of course, and choose whatever works best in post.
My title is production sound mixer, and my job is to record sound at the time the film's shot. So, like the scene that we're doing today, we've got a whole heap of characters who are all going to be doing lines, which means I've got to put out a number of microphones, and I'll mix all that chat together to record the actor's dialogue. We're doing a master, and there's a lot of characters talking, so we need to put out a lot of mics. So there'll be boom mics, there'll be plant mics or radio mics on people.
You think this is about sound? It's actually not. You're doing me for drugs.
But what if neither works? Or what if you need a cleaner take of something than you were able to capture on set?
All right, guys, we're ready for some Groot. You ready?
First cue up.
One way to address this is called automated dialogue replacement, or ADR.
You want to rehearse on it, Lynn?
ADR involves looping a line that was recorded on set so that an actor can pick up on the subtleties of speed and cadence in their original delivery and recreate it. The actor performs in sync with the field recording, generally in repetition, until a take is captured that adequately matches the footage.
Yo soy Groot. Yo soy Groot. Yo soy Groot.
Bad ADR is very noticeable.
Oh, well. Look here, old sport. What is your opinion of me anyhow?
My opinion?
Yes, yes, your opinion. I don't want you to get the wrong impression from all these bizarre accusations you must be hearing. A pack of lies, I guarantee. You've heard the story.
Oh, well.
I will tell you God's truth. God's truth about myself. I'm the son of some very wealthy people from the Middle West. Sadly, all of them are dead now. I was brought up in America, but educated at Oxford because all my ancestors have been educated there for many years. You see, it's a family tradition.
The way he spoke, no wonder people thought he was lying.
But when captured and mixed properly, it should be indistinguishable to the viewer from an on-set recording. You may even want to go back and capture other parts of an actor's performance. Breaths and grunts that can be impossible to capture properly on set. But what about other sounds? This is where a Foley artist comes in.
Why do these tapes all have women's names on them?
Well, I enjoy interviewing women more than men. Oh. It's iced tea.
Thanks.
Do you want some lemon?
No, this is perfect.
Those were her footsteps and ice cubes you heard. Please welcome Foley sound recording artist Vanessa Ament. Vanessa? Hi. How are you? Pleasure to meet you. Thank you very much for being here. The word Foley, what does that mean exactly? Is that a technique, a machine?
Well, it's actually named for a sound editor by the name of Jack Foley, who decided that he was going to stop cutting in footsteps for movies and start performing them live in sync to picture and then record them. So we sort of called it after him.
I see. And you're going to show us the technique. I guess
you
watch part of the film and then you make up the effects, right?
I do. It's a weird job. What can I tell you? Okay, well, what you just saw was from Sex, Lies, and Videotape, and ice cubes oftentimes will be big pen tops. Don't try this at home, kids. So I'm shaking around like that.
Right. And of course, the obvious question is, why not just ice cubes?
Because that would...
Because they make the ink sloppy when you try to put the pen back
in. Exactly. You knew that.
No, but I mean, seriously, why? How much different could that be?
Well, oftentimes ice cubes melt.
Ice cubes melt.
And sometimes they will record too bassy and they won't sound right. It depends on the particular stage.
I have
some other things here I'd like to show you, too, if that's
okay. I guess we're moving on.
Is that okay?
I had a couple of more questions about the ice cubes. Why not plastic ice cubes?
That's a good idea. I'll try that. You've got a new career.
If you listen to a scene in a movie without Foley, it's clear how much life Foley artists bring to a film. This takes experimentation. But it also requires paying close attention to what a film is trying to evoke, and trusting your ear to identify something that matches, even if the solution makes no logical sense.
We'll be back before Andy gets home.
Every sound that's going to happen in the film needs to be addressed. So we do have to come up with a whole wagon load of sound effects to get started on a film like this. Now, this is such a classic sound for these bendable straws. A joint movement. We're looking for different ratchet sounds for Barbie's joints move.
One of the most unique sounds in the film was for an overexcited and sloppy horse called Bullseye. Rydstrom was prepared to do anything for the perfect sound.
I had somebody here volunteer to smother their face with peanut butter.
To get the best slurping noises, the poor volunteer had peanut butter licked off his face by a hungry cow. After recording the cow's mouth-watering meal, Rydstrom separated and enhanced each lick and sniff to find the right effect.
Into just licks, you know, taken away from all the other stuff. So really close-up, disgusting licks.
Whether you're doing your own Foley work or sourcing sounds from an effects library, don't be afraid to get inventive, weird, and creative, not only with what you use, but with how you combine sounds. In the second Terminator movie, a simple shotgun sound effect involved combining a pistol fire,
get down,
a cannon fire,
get down,
a sped-up cannon fire,
get down,
and a rifle fire echoing through a canyon.
Get down.
Any of these sounds alone would have been fine, but together they make a hyper-realistic sound effect that matches the bravado and intensity of the film's world.
Get down.
As a beginner, capturing good sound can be daunting, especially when you're still figuring out the visual aspects of filmmaking. But even as an emerging filmmaker on a budget, there are a few basic things you can do to improve sound.
Take it.
For starters, try to always use external mics, not just whatever is built into your camera, and try getting as close to your subject as possible. Also, make sure you use a recorder that lets you adjust gain or the audio level that you're recording at. You're going to want to avoid overmodulating, which is recording at a loudness that exceeds your device's ability to capture it. Because of this, it's helpful to have someone dedicated to monitoring audio. It's also helpful to use a dedicated audio recorder if possible, often referred to as a dual system, as opposed to plugging the mic directly into your camera, or single system. If you're shooting dual system, make sure to still capture reference audio on your camera. Most modern editing software can automatically analyze this audio and sync your externally captured audio with it, along with other camera angles if you're shooting with more than one camera. Also, use a film slate or clap your hands in front of the camera so that you have a visual sync point to fall back on. But the most important thing is to deliberately mic your subjects and anything else that will help fill the soundscape of the world you're creating. Even if you don't have access to professional gear, the microphone on your smartphone can sound surprisingly good if placed near your subject. Experiment, monitor your audio closely, and be deliberate about your decisions.